please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Good afternoon. Welcome to Halftime Report. I'm Sumesh Shenoy. Sonia, good afternoon to you. Well, for our market, we're up about a quarter odd percent for the frontline indices. And, you know, it's a good day because if you compare it to what our Asian peers are doing, you know, say a market like Shanghai losing ground, a couple of them flat. So compared to them, we're doing a tad bit better, actually. So the frontline indices up about a quarter odd percent and the mid-cap index just about flat right now. So a bit of underperformance. Let's get started with movers and shakers. Our research team is here to tell you about all the stocks which are buzzing and why. And first up, of course, is Info Edge. So the company has gone shopping and Mangalam is here to tell us everything we need to know. Mangalam.
Absolutely. Not just shopping, they've shopped for some insurance products out here. So they've bought about $45 million worth stake in policybazaar.com. Remember, Info Edge, along with SoftBank, has invested about $90 million for 8.93% stake in the company eTech Aces, which runs policybazaar.com. So the company will put in $45 million, the other $45 million coming in from SoftBank. With this, what basically happens is they put in 300 crore rupees. They had earlier invested 16 crore rupees for some stake, which we do not know the quantum of, and now they get an additional control of 4.5%, which is Info Edge's stake itself. Morgan Stanley is pretty positive on the stock. They have a target price of 1900 rupees on the back of this, and they say that this move, which is about 20% of the total cash that they have on their books, shows the company's ability to go ahead and buy significant chunks of investments, as well as go and step up the kind of stake that they want to in companies which they believe will grow. We spoke with the management. They have close to around 1800 crores of cash in their books, and they are constantly looking out for more startups. In fact, the commentary that came in, they indicated that they have 15 more projects that they're looking at in the future. So let's actually hear out the management and hear him out, actually.
Our initial stake was, you know, obviously, you know, we put some 16 crore to get some good amount of stake over there. But over a period of time, it has been kind of diluted, and we have been getting new and newer partners, you know, on board. And we have all marquee investors now in this company. And company is on a very strong, you know, growth trajectory, you know. So this, after this round, you know, the valuation in this private market is about $1 billion plus kind of a valuation. Their consolidated turnover is about more than 300 crore. And obviously, this is the insurance commission that we are talking about. We are sitting on large amount of cash. Cash has been central to our strategy. And we would be happy if there are, you know, more such opportunities available to us for more investment. We already have about 15 investments which are live with us, you know. Of course, two or three are most talked about. The others are at a very early stage. But we would be happy to do the follow-on round in these investments, the one which we have already done. And plus, we are always looking for new startups. We have cash on a balance sheet. On our balance sheet is something like about $275 million, about 1,800 crores.
Okay, that's the word coming in from Info Edge. But the stock of the moment in the pharmaceutical space is Aurobindo Pharma. Some positive news flow coming in there. Ekta will tell us more. Ekta. Aurobindo Pharmaceuticals is in focus because they've got an approval which the street was anticipating for quite a long time, which is ertapenem. It is an anti-infective drug, so, or rather injection, so it is used for high-end bacterial infections. Now, it is important because it's expected to be a limited competition drug, around $380 million in terms of market size. And Aurobindo could probably make $100 million annually in terms of sales, which could trickle down to around $50 to $60 million in terms of profit for Aurobindo from this particular drug. Just want to point out that it is important, and the company, however, had guided for this approval for the in the first half of FY19. So maybe the street had an inkling that this approval is going to come through, and hence maybe there is the exuberance is rather capped for Aurobindo simply because the street was probably factoring it in.
Ekta, thanks very much for that. The last 1 month has actually seen quite a bit of fall for the Ashok Leyland stock. Today, of course, the stock is higher by a percent. And we spoke with the management earlier this morning. Vinod Dasari, the MD, says that he expects a lot of good things in FY19 as well as FY20. Here, Matt, he was speaking to us from the Ambit India Access Conference in London.
I think FY19 is going to be pretty good. The industry volume is still growing. Partly because of the growth in GST post GDP post the GST, so we're seeing a hub and spoke where the larger trucks are selling and the more large trucks that sell, the better for Ashok Leyland, because that's where we are stronger. The other thing that's happening is infrastructure build. The construction is going on very strong, so tippers are growing very well. It'll be slight slowdown in July and August because of the monsoon, but I think the construction will be back again. And so I'm quite bullish this year. I think the overall volume should grow by about 10%. The RM cost was higher in the beginning, and we did take a pricing action, so our margins are actually better now than before. And I expect the RM cost to stabilize. I don't think it'll go up much more.
Okay, all right. That's the outlook coming in from Vinod Dasari. He says a 10% growth is what he's expecting in the new year. Perhaps a little conservative. That's the case. That's the way they've always been in the past. GMC Projects has bagged new orders worth almost 2,000 crores. We spoke with Manoj Tulsian, the whole-time director and the CFO of the company, to know more about the contours of that deal and the outlook going ahead. Listen into what he had to say. The stock is one of the big movers in trade today.
These irrigation projects which we have received has to be completed within a period of 42 months. So there are two projects. One has to be done in 36 months and the other one in 42 months. These order books, we will be close, very close to 10,000 crores, right? And for this year, we had declared in the month of April around 940 crores of order, which was on flyovers, again on the infra side. And taking this together, we are now close to around 2,900 crores already in the first 3 months. Our earlier guidance was close to around 4,500 crores. But we feel that we have good amount of L1 orders still in hand, more than 1,000 crores. So we would be crossing 4,500 crores.
All right, so let's recap then the list of buzzing stocks. There's Info Edge at the top of the pack, Aurobindo Pharma, Ashok Leyland, JMC Projects. All right, well, there's a lot to look out for today as well. Heads of 11 state-owned banks will brief a parliamentary committee today about the problems of mounting bad loans and increasing fraud cases. Rituparna Buyana, correspondent, joins us on the telephone line with more details on what the likely agenda could be. Ritu.
The meeting is on at the moment. The Standing Committee on Finance is actually preparing a report which is titled Banking Sector in India, Issues, Challenges, and a Way Forward, including NPAs, Stress Assets in Banks and Financial Institutions. So banks like IDBI Bank, UCO Bank, Central Bank of India, so basically the banks which are under the PCA framework of the RBI, they are briefing the parliamentary panel. Remember that this parliamentary panel has very illustrious members, including Manmohan Singh, former Prime Minister of India, former Finance Minister of India, and also former Reserve Bank Governor. So in addition to that, you have MPs like Rajiv Chandrasekhar as well. And, of course, this panel is headed by Veerappa Moily, who has been, you know, who has been tracking the NPA issue very closely. So we expect the PSB bank chiefs to request by these members of parliament on issues related to NPAs and stressed assets.
Okay, Ritu, thanks a lot for that. So we'll keep tracking that panel meet very closely. For now, let's take a short break. Up next, we'll get you an exclusive conversation with the Minister of State for Aviation, Jayant Sinha, on whether LIC will bail out Air India or not. Stay tuned. Hi guys, welcome back. You're still watching Halftime Report on CNBC TV18. It's actually picking up not so much the headline index, but you know, a lot of stocks are looking pretty good. Pull up the chart of Godrej Consumers. Today that stock has hit a new high. It's up 2.5%. It is, the volumes are picking up. And in the last 1 year, the stock has gone from about 900, I think, now sitting at about 1200 rupees. So Godrej Consumers is the stock I'm talking about. Looking pretty good there. Bharat Financial Inclusion is the other one. Astral Polytech. That's the stock that you know our market master Gautam Trivedi was talking about. He did talk about how they're going big in the adhesives business. Astral Polytechnic is the stock that'll come up for you. That one too is up about 5-odd%. But I will not speculate and I will not be pinned down. That's not me. That was the response coming in from the Minister of State for Civil Aviation, Jayant Sinha, when asked about the possibility of LIC buying stake in Air India. Speaking exclusively to Shireen Bhan, Sinha made it clear that the government is considering all alternatives in national interest. Here is a snippet of that conversation.
Market conditions and industry dynamics are such that today people would not be that enthused about the disinvestment process that was underway as far as Air India is concerned. Mm. And of course, if we look at how various airlines are doing around the world, particularly the full service carriers, you'll see that higher oil prices, currency fluctuations, higher interest rates have sharply brought down profitability. So therefore, I think the conclusion as industry watchers that we would have to come to is that the expression of interest was not sufficiently of interest to various bidders. And please recognize also, and I think there's some confusion about this, please recognize that all we were asking for was an expression of interest. These were not binding bids. We were not even at the RFP stage. We were a long way from the RFP stage. All that the expression of interest required you to do was to put a viable consortia together and then come in and start taking a longer, harder look at all of the details and be somebody who had access to the data room.
Our feedback right through this process has been that the government retaining 24% was a deal breaker. And I'll tell you why. Because look at companies like Hindustan Zinc and Balco. These were divested in the first tenure of the NDA government. And the government continues to hold on to the residual stake that they hold in these companies. And that is why potential bidders were wary of the government wanting to hold on to 24%.
Shireen, there are many other instances that would argue exactly the opposite. For instance, if you look at the holdings that we have in some banks like Axis and ICICI, government has of course continued its passive financial stake. It has not interfered in any operational way with those companies. If you look at Maruti, for instance, where government had a stake for a long period of time, eventually government did exit from those. So obviously there are arguments to be made on both sides. At the end of the day, as far as the offer for sale, what we had put up in terms of terms and conditions for the sale are concerned, I think they were very balanced. They were, taking into account all the various different stakeholder interests that we had to consider. And therefore, our objective of ensuring that Indians had an independent, globally competitive airline which could fly long haul around the world, those being our overriding objectives were fully maintained through this very balanced offer for sale that we had put out.
Mm-hmm. What now, Mr. Sinha, as far as Air India is concerned, are you going to attempt to take the disinvestment process forward at this point? Will you rework the terms that had been put in place in the EOI, or is the divestment off the table altogether for now? And my second question, and I'll ask you this in the context of what we're already seeing with LIC potentially getting ownership of IDBI Bank, there have been reports suggesting that LIC could even be brought into Air India. Is that a realistic possibility?
Again, Shireen, I cannot speculate to the future. You understand the decision-making process that has been established within government for these kinds of situations. We have an executive committee of joint secretaries. We have a core group on disinvestment, which is chaired by the cabinet secretary. Then we have a very senior group of ministers, which is the Air India specific alternative mechanism that monitors the situation and then takes decisions. So we have multiple decision layers. We will be monitoring the situation as we move forward. And whatever is in the best national interest, you can be sure that all of these very accomplished and capable professionals and senior decision makers will make whatever is in the right national interest and take that forward.
Including possibly bringing LIC on board to fund Air India. Has that been discussed in any fashion at all, Mr. Sinha?
Shireen, you're asking me once again to speculate. I've already told you.
No, I'm asking you if this has been discussed in any form of fashion. We are
considering all alternatives that will be in the national interest, and we will take them through the process and undertake those decisions that are the best for the people of India.
All right, on that note, we'll take a very quick break. Come back in a bit. There's lots more lined up. We'll also get in a few market guests. Europe will open up in about 10 minutes. So all of that in just a bit. Stay tuned. Welcome back. So building on a little bit now, the Nifty is getting closer to that 10,800-odd mark, and the Sensex seems to be climbing closer to 35,600 now, so 120 points now higher on the Sensex. Here's some market opinion coming in. Gautam Trivedi of Nepean Capital spoke with us this morning. And we asked him actually to gauge the outlook for the market, some of the stocks that he would be betting on in FY19. So let's hear him out.
I think the market is going to basically drift until the next elections, because we've got a bunch of events, including other elections, a very stock pickers market going forward, and I think has been for the start of this year at least. And I think there are a bunch of issues that are facing and plaguing the market. Of course, foreigners are continuing to exit the market. We've seen the number now swell to $750 million of net outflows year to date. So that's a big number in itself. ICICI Bank is now trading at 1.1 times price to book. It's cheaper than even SBI. Not taking anything away from SBI, but the fact is it's, you know, and a lot of people benchmark the two together. I think until the Chanda Kochar issue is not fully resolved, and I don't want to be a judge on which way it's going to go, but the reality is I think a lot of investors are staying away from the stock for that very reason. Stocks, I think, that have listed in India, have the headquarters and the manufacturing bases in India, but their business is mostly offshore. So Mothers and Sumi, I think I discussed this the last time as well on your show, which I think is phenomenal. I'm tempted to look at pharma as a space where businesses are overseas and but they're headquartered in India, but I think that's still some time away. You know, you're seeing a lot of places where there are generational changes and shifts taking place. So if you look at Cadila, as Mr. Pankaj Patel, you know, has handed over the reins to his son, I think he's a very competent guy. Every industry has got a leader like a Bajaj Finance, which has just been a, you know, significant rock, you know, rocking compounding story. I mean, the market cap is, of course, more than Bajaj Auto now. But the reality is, I think that company is going to just go from strength to strength. Phenomenal leadership. And anybody holding the stock should continue to own it. I think a lot of companies are starting to attack the adhesive space. So Astral, for example, is now going after that space as well. And again, a great story, done a phenomenal job in the CPVC market. And I hope they can repeat the success in adhesives as well. I'd rather buy, given the onslaught and given the pain that's going on in the telecom space, I'd rather buy companies that are beneficiaries of the 4G movement, which is, let's say, Saregama or Shimaru.
Okay, so those are some interesting ideas from Gautam Trivedi. He speaks about Saregama, Shimaru, Astra, Poly, Mothers and Sumi, etc. You'll, of course, get to hear them through the course of the day. But for now, let's move on and talk about some other stories. The top management team of Geodesic was arrested by authorities recently. CNBC TV18 has now accessed the money trail which investigative agencies are following in the alleged 1,000 crore Geodesic scam. Utkarsh Chaturvedi has all the details for us. Utkarsh, what are you picking up?
So we accessed the charge sheet which was filed yesterday in this case, and we got to know how this scam really took place. Now, if you look at the whole process, Geodesic Limited raised around FCCBs worth $125 million in the name of acquiring a listed NASDAQ firm. But the company did not invest in buying the NASDAQ firm, instead diverted it to a fund called EMMS. Now they told EMMS to send it to six firms, namely Zomo Technology, Sharp Law Consultant, License Ventures, etc. And all of these companies were from British Virgin Islands. Now, these firms were acting as a collection agent for their marketing firm itself, which was called GTSL, which was Geodesic Technologies Limited, which was based in Hong Kong. Now, these six collection agents, by showing fake sales and purchase receipts, sent this money to the marketing arm, and also they showed ledgers and sales receipts to around 44 companies. They, all of these 44 companies were based in Latin America. So now the money came to the marketing arm, which was the Geodesic Technologies Limited. From Geodesic Technologies, the money, 75% of that money went to Geodesic Limited, the parent company. And then from the parent company, they showed fake purchase receipts to around six dummy companies in India. And then the money was siphoned off to these six companies. It was a complete money trade in this case. Around four arrests have taken place. In fact, Dinesh Jaluria, who was the CEO in this case, has also been named in Panama Papers, which had come recently. So clearly, we'll have to really wait and watch the whole investigation goes through. We have all the money trail for you exclusively from the charge sheet.
All right, Utkarsh, thanks very much for that comprehensive note on how the money has moved through Geodesic. For now, we'll take a very quick break. Come back in a bit. It'll be time to track the technicals of trade. Mitesh Thakkar and Rajat Bose will join in with fresh ideas. Stay tuned.